believe in all your hard work on this. So this is, do I?
That's not the special.
Oh, this is, okay, this is, and this is on you. All right, we'll do, can we do the fake before I start?
Thank you very much, and thank you.
Down the front.
Since we did the real work, but let me just get back, and I know Rob has to sneak out, and as we reassembled, just express gratitude. I won't repeat a lot of what was said, except to reinforce my pride in this moment, pride in the leadership of those assembled here, in absentia, the Attorney General, his hard work and steadfastness in the space, to both senators and, of course, Assemblymember has stepped up his expectations of all of us to do more and do better and maintain our national leadership with this first in the nation bill that I just signed as it relates to this 11% excise tax. Look, California has led the modern gun rights movement back in 1967 for different and curious reasons that was initiated. California, recognizing its role and responsibility to do more and be better, really accelerated those efforts in the late 80s, 1989, establishing the first assault weapons ban in the nation after the devastation of a shooting that shocked the nation in Stockton, California. That's remarkable to look back on the Stockton incident and consider how routinized now that has become. I said it shocked the nation, and it compelled this state to action in 1989. In fact, it was Ronald Reagan himself. Many of the Republicans may want to look him up before they show up to the Reagan Library, that not only signed that first bill in 1967, but advocated in 1989 for an assault weapons ban. Ronald Reagan himself advocated for that assault weapons ban in 1989. A ban, by the way, that Judge Benitez, federal judge, throughout months ago, prior to Bruin, saying the AR-15 platform is nothing more than a Swiss Army knife. More on that in a moment. That movement accelerated with Senator Feinstein's leadership in 1994. In the 1990s, California accelerated its leadership even more formally, and that's represented in the numbers that the Attorney General advanced. We saw a significant decline in gun death rate in the state of California between the years when the state asserted its leadership and moral authority, and we continued to lead that national conversation as we do again today, because good enough never is. We recognize humbly we're not solving in every one of the cases for an incident, we're solving for a pattern, and that's an important point. Inevitably, this national debate always is tripped up by saying, well, this law wouldn't have solved for this. But there is a pattern that's solved from leadership, and that pattern is being advanced here in terms of the strategies and solutions that we know statistically, the data bears fruit, save lives, and reduce gun violence and gun deaths. It's not an assertion. The facts are overwhelming. The work that we collectively and those that are assembled here with their moral authority have demanded of us have saved lives. And so we have a responsibility to do more and continue to lead in that conversation. But I will close, and we can have a conversation in terms of the Q&A more broadly on the specifics of the bills. But I do want to make the point that I reference as it relates to Judge Benitez. And again, I've said this on many occasions. I'll repeat it on many more occasions. As someone who is the son of a judge on the California Court of Appeals, I'm not prone to want to call out the judge by name, but nor is a judge immune as a public servant when they wear that robe from criticism or critique. Judge Benitez, just a week or so ago, throughout federal judge in San Diego, throughout California's leading bill, and one of our leading bills as it relates to large capacity magazine clips. You have to read the decision you're not surprised, but read it to understand what we're up against. Judge Nelson, Federalist Society judge that was appointed by Donald Trump himself throughout our nation-leading efforts as an 18 to 21-year-old to buy a long gun. Got to be, I think, seems obvious to anyone that, you know, if you can't buy a beer, you shouldn't be able to buy a weapon of war. But Judge Nelson felt differently. And of course, this was prior to Bruin. That case is also being sent back in a Bruin context under even more difficult circumstances as it relates to the Bruin test itself in both those incidences. But those judges have both gone on record in throwing out those federal laws. The point is pretty damn obvious to anyone's paying attention. It's great what we're doing, but it may not be enough. I've been talking about the forces of transformation, the forces of restoration, those that want to take us back to a pre-1960s world. You've seen that with rights regression on voting rights, civil rights, LGBTQ rights. You've seen it as it relates to the assault on women freedom, reproductive freedom, and contraception. But they're also trying to roll back nationalized rights or states' rights that have been long afforded in states like California as it relates to gun safety. We're no longer immune from those assaults. You can't just be a blue state and advance a blue state framework. They're coming after these laws and they're winning in federal courts. And under the Bruin test, which we're very mindful of, and I hope that you heard the Attorney General when we drafted the bill, in Senator Portantino's bill, that it was drafted with Bruin in mind. This is a serious moment. And it requires perhaps a pivot in the way we approach the issue of gun safety in this country. We cannot live with sense of immunity from what's happening in terms of the rights regression or the nationalization of that diminution of rights with guns and, of course, in all of these other categories.